The introduction part. In the introduction part, I would like to cover the most important topics about machine learning. So, what is machine learning? It is all about extracting knowledge from data. We put the data into the data set and we would like to extract some information, some knowledge from this data set. It's a research field, very popular nowadays. And we mostly use the statistic, artificial intelligence, and computer science all together is a mixture of them. And of course, mathematics. And also we can define this area as predictive analysis or statistical learning. We apply the machine learning into real life problems every day actually. For example, when you use the social media like Facebook, Amazon, Netflix kind of things, they all use machine learning to provide their services better. Also, outside of these commercial applications, we can use the machine learning in these related areas like understanding stars and their locations and their interaction with each other, finding distant planets even we cannot see, discovering new particles, analyzing DNA sequences, providing personalized cancer treatments. So we can use machine learning in many places to solve the problems. In this chapter, I try to explain why machine learning has become so popular, discuss what kind of problems can be solved using machine, and show you how to build your first machine learning model and introduce the important concepts briefly. Today we are living in intelligent applications area. So it means that many systems use some intelligence to solve the problem or to provide the services. We can do these intelligent solutions simply using if and else decision process. So we can hard code the rules. So we can create a rule based, basically saying that do this if it happens like that. For example, in the spam filter, so when you receive a mail, maybe it's a spam, how can you create a spam filter? Basically, nowadays, basically, we can create a list of words. So if these words exist in the incoming mail, we can automatically put this mail into spam folder. So we create a blacklist of words. So what we have done is a rule-based system. You put the rule, you apply the rule to the input. If the rule is valid for that input, you take some actions against the input. So that's the basic intelligent application. It is called rule-based systems or expert systems. So what would be the problem in that system? First of all, the logic required to make a decision is specific to a single domain and task. If you create a rule-based system for spam emails, you cannot use this system for selecting or validating credit applications because they are two different domains. The second thing is that changing the task even slightly might require a rewrite of the whole system. Assume that you write your rule-based system for spam identification. If the mail has only image, the picture, how can you apply your rule? So you cannot apply your rule because your rule is basically working on the text because we are using the words. Blacklist of words. The third one is designing rules requires a deep understanding how a decision should be made by a human expert. The first systems, for example, rule-based systems are designed for just understanding if a person is sick or from which illness, for example. So you need the hundreds of doctors to come together to write set of rules to identify the sickness correctly. So it is a burden. It is very, very tedious job to create all these experts to work together. And it is prone to errors. Detecting faces in images, for example, is an unsolved problem recently in 2001. Why? Because you know that the detecting faces in images, when we say that the images are converted to binary format, digitized. In the digitized format, we have the pixels, and each pixels have RGB color values, and these values are between 0 and 1 floating number or between 0 and 255 integer numbers. They are just numbers. So how can you perceive the face in these number? So assume that it's just a matrix of numbers. So this representation of the data is different what we see and what a computer can see. We see the image, but the computer see is a matrix of floating numbers. So it's not easy to set up rules to the computer. You can teach a children, teach children that to recognize, for example, an animal. If you say that this is an elephant, a child can understand it is an elephant, but you cannot tell a computer and say it's a face and the computer, because the computer cannot see how we see the data. So the representation of data for us and for the computer is totally different. Therefore, we need to set up new rules. For example, the human being brain can understand that face is composed of the eyes, nose, mouth, ears, etc. But the computer cannot understand the face like that because it doesn't know ears, eyes, nose, and etc. Because it sees only the matrix of floating numbers. There's a huge difference. The difference is here, the representation of the data, and it determines the set of rules to be accomplished to the job. So using machine learning, however, instead of defining the set of rules, we can simply present a program with a large collection of images of faces is enough for an algorithm to determine what characteristics are needed to identify a face. So the computer itself will be teaching itself to recognize the faces in these numbers. Basically, we have kinds of problems and, of course, kinds of solutions. The first typical kind of problem and the solution is supervised learning. So what it means? Supervised learning means that we would like to automate decision-making process by generalizing from known examples. The user provides the algorithm with pairs of inputs and desired outputs, and the algorithm finds a way to produce the desired output given an input. The algorithm is able to create an output from an input it has never seen before. Let me give you some simple example. Assume that we have an algorithm like that, okay, and then we provide a table. In that table, assume that we have many samples of data. Okay, many samples of data. It goes like that. In each, assume that, again, we have some features. For example, We would like to classify a flower and we want to know the flower type. So let me put here, this column has the flower, let's say height, for example, 1 meter. And this is the width of the leaf. I don't know, for example, 0.5 centimeters. And here we have lots of other features of a flower. And what is that flower? For that, we can provide here the answer. So in that answer, we basically have these lines, samples, instances, corresponding these measurements. Okay, here we can put here a rose, for example. And I don't know, we can put here lilac. And we can put here other flower names. And these are the measurements, I don't know, from the real life. And there are lots of measurements for the labeled flowers. So this is a sample from real life. Each row is a sample from real life with the measurements. And these are the labels of these samples. So it means that this sample is a rose, this sample is a lilac, and this sample is something. Okay, so this is our machine learning model. So what we do basically, we provide all this information to our algorithm, and we also provide the correct labels. So we provide the measurements and labels. So the machine learning algorithm looks for the measurement of the first sample and the correct label, and looks for the second measurement and its correct label. So it tries to learn the relationship between the measurement and the label. So you can think that as a function, that function takes the measurement and the labels and learns the relationship between. Okay. And then if we need a test, or if we are given just the measurement, let's assume that. Oh, I'm sorry. Let me repeat this. By the way, this process is called training. Let me put here. This process is called training. At the end of the training, we hope that the machine learning model, our function, learns the relation between measurement and the label. After training, now we can provide this model with a new data. Assume that that's our new data. And in the new data, we have the some measurements of some unknown flowers. Okay. So again, assume that we have some measurements, I don't know, 2, 0.3, 1, 1.2, and like that. But now we don't know the labels. So we don't know the label, this one. We don't know the label, this one. And now we provide these data, the measurement data, to our model. And our model will provide the result. For example, rose, and for example, again, the rose. So that's the whole thing. And this phase is called training. I'm sorry, testing. This is called testing. In training, we provide the, let me go over again. In training, we go over the measurement and the labels given to the R model at the same time, okay? And model train itself for the given measurement, for the given label, and it learn. After finishing the training, we can now provide an unknown new data to the model, and now model produce the output. Am I clear? Any problem with that? That's called supervised learning. Why supervised? Because there is a teacher providing the sample of the problem with the correct answer. So that's the question. For example, that's the answer to the question. So the model now learns how to solve the question with the correct answer. So that's called why supervised model. So we provide the input, the measurement, the desired output, the labels, and the model learned by itself a relationship between the input to the output so that it can produce the output for the unseen inputs. And that's called supervised learning. Why? A teacher provides supervision to the algorithm in the form of the desired outputs for each example that they learn from. There are many examples in this kind of problem. For example, identifying the zip code from handwritten digits on an envelope. How can you provide the input output for training for that problem? Basically, you collect the image of the handwritten digits as the input, and the output will be the numbers actually. And then you provide these input output pairs as a training set to the model. The second, determining whether a tumor is benign based on a medical image. So what would be the training data here? The training data will be maybe the images as the input, and the output is 1 or 0. If it is benign, it is 1. If it's not benign, it is gonna be 0. And detecting fraudulent activity in credit card transaction, if some mistaken or somebody on purpose that try to cheat you in credit card transactions, how can you do this? You provide the many transactions, and as a label, you provide 1 or 0 number. 1 means that this transaction is fraudulent. If 0, it means that this transaction does not have any problem. Okay, so basically, according to these each problem, the idea is to prepare an input and output pair, right? Such that in that pair, you provide some input and corresponding correct output. Okay, in the input part, there could be different things. For example, input could be a table of numbers, right? Or it could be an image file, or it could be, for example, sound file, or it could be anything, okay? But basically, you need to convert all this input numerical format. Then this output could be anything, but in general, we call this output is label, if it is just a categorical output, or it could be just numerical as well. So it could be, I mean, that label as a rows, or if it is bearing B or normal, okay, it could be anything to symbolize the label, or it could be numerical. So numerical means that, for example, if you try to find the next year dollar price, it could be, you know, for example, 7.08 kind of numerical value as well. And our machine learning algorithm here, machine learning method, takes these and these to prepare itself to learn the relationship between the input and the output during training. Okay, when you done the training, when it's finished the training, we hope that this machine learning method understands whenever it's given the input, it can create the correct output. That's the whole story about supervised learning. Is it clear? Any questions so far? These are the main classes. So we learned the supervised learning. Now let's talk about unsupervised learning. In unsupervised learning, only the input data is known and no known output data is given to the algorithm, machine learning algorithm. Examples, identifying topics in a set of blog posts. So let me go over and explain this for you. Assume that we are given a set of blogs. So these are the many blogs. Okay. In each blog, we have some text inside. And we know that in that text, maybe there are two or three topics. In the text, two, three main topics. Okay, in each text, in each blog post. Now, the question is that what each blog post talking about, the topic, what is the topic? But at the beginning, we don't know what is the topic. If we know the topic here, then it's very easy. And we don't need to ask this question to the machine learning model, right? So here is the machine learning model. And we are asking the topics, but we cannot provide the example set because it's not easy to create, read, and provide these. But we would like to expect that machine learning method will produce it. So basically, we cannot give in that format as in supervised. In supervised, we provide the, remember that, for example, the measurement and the corresponding labels. And we expect that machine learning method train itself by using these and create the model. But here, we cannot provide the correct answer for that post work. So we don't have the correct format. So how can we teach the machine learning? So we cannot teach by ourselves. There is no teacher. So it is unsupervised. We let the machine learning works itself alone to learn these number of topics from each blog post. So it's called unsupervised learning. And in real life, there are many, 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 many problems to be solved by using this approach. We are gonna see the details later. We are just now introduced the main topics. Okay. Let's continue if we have no problem. All right. I mentioned that the representation of data is really important and is really different from the point of the human being and the computer or the machine learning model. For both supervised and unsupervised learning tasks, it is important to have a representation of your input data that a computer can understand. Often it's helpful to think of your data as a table, as I shown in the example, a row, each data point, each email, each customer, each transaction, each flower. So it is a sample from real life problem, a sample. A column, on the other hand, is a property of that sample, is a property of that sample. It means that it is, for example, the width of a leaf of a flower, the color of the flower. I don't know, this kind of features of the sample. And so we create the row and column structure to define our problem and each of the samples in that problem. So naming can have several things. So we use the entity and sample exchangeably for the row. So in the table, entity or a sample is the same thing. For the columns, we can say attribute, features are, or dimension of the problem are the same. So you need to learn this terminology, because when I, in your project dataset presentation, you need to say that we have 1,200 samples and we have 30 features. So you need to use this kind of terminology. Okay. Here you see that an example, a data set about cars. I will go over cars. So here, what happens? Here, each row is a sample or entity, each row. Okay. Each column, here you see that, is a feature. Okay, is a feature. I will use some graphics, so I will stop and start. This is the feature. Each of them is a feature. Here is the name of the feature is cylinders. Here is the feature name is displacement. And it goes like that. Okay, these are the features. And let me put the samples or entities. So each row is a entity or sample. Okay. What about this left side? Actually, this left side is an important and different thing, because you notice the color, background color here. This is the target value. Okay, so the target value in the training set, we use this target value, you know, in the training set to decide the output of the machine learning model. Okay. For that label, we have these feature values in that sample. So let me show another example we can focus on here. For example, this one, if you notice that. First of all, what you have seen here, what you have seen here is a training data set. Okay. So the total of them is here, training data set or train set, basically the same train set. Remember that in the train set we have the measurements and plus labels. Now here you see that these are the measurements from here to here, and each measurement has a name, and these are called Of course, the features. Okay. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We have 6 features. And this is called the target feature. Target. So that is the actually output. Right? In the training set, remember that you provide the measurement and the label. So this is the target label. So the problem is that if somebody gives you the cylinder number, the displacement, the horsepower, etc., etc., so can you guess what is the type of that car? What is the brand of that car? Can you guess this? So here is the correct answer. It's a Ford blah, 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 blah. So in that problem, the data set, you see that train data set, composed of the measurements as a feature from here to here, and the label, correct label in the train data set. In the train. Of course, in the test data set, we don't provide this site, but we provide only the measurement and ask the what could it be. And we expect that it learns. Now, do you see, everybody sees what I'm showing? Burak, Altun?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Any questions? Do you have any questions? Okay. So that's a train data set. In the train data set, we have the features, and we have the target label, and the number of the features here, 6, and the target label is only 1. Okay, so the features are the input, target label is the output. It's really important that you understand these concepts. So building a good data representation is called feature extraction or feature engineering, because when you collect the data, even if it's collected by somebody else, it has some features, but some of the features are maybe not so useful, or you need to apply some processing on the features such that it would be more useful. So we will learn about this feature extraction, feature engineering at the last week. Now, please keep in mind that machine learning is not a magical stick, okay? So no machine learning algorithm will be able to make a prediction on data for which it has no information. Let me give you an example for this. For example, if you collect the information about some patients, and if you want to predict the patient gender, if in the data there is only last name feature, you cannot predict the gender because there is no information. But if in the collected data, there is a column, there is a feature, there is an attribute for the name, then most probably you can train the system to learn from name to gender mapping. So the popular saying in machine learning, garbage in, garbage out, GIGO. What it means? It means that if your data, it means that your features are not enough to create the model, to train the model. So you cannot create the relationship between input and output because of your features. So you don't expect a model can learn it. So you need to focus on your data set. If the features are enough to create a relationship between the input and the output. So you need to focus on your data before the model itself. So before working on tuning up the parameters, selecting the model, before this, please focus on the data. So data comes first. It means that we need the No means that analyze. Analyze means that get familiar with your data and you need to explore your data in details before creating your model. It's really, really, really important. Otherwise, selecting some random algorithm and apply it onto the data will not provide you the expected results, expected accuracy. Okay, so each machine learning algorithm is designed for a specific purpose we are gonna learn, a specific structured data. So you cannot randomly select machine learning algorithms to apply every data set, but you need to understand your data set. Therefore, in the project, we are gonna spend 2 presentations for your data. And in the project report, you will see that there is a big chapter for the data exploration. So you need to apply some methods and you need to read and understand the results of the graphs, charts, figures, so you can grab understanding of your data. It's really important. So throughout your project, you will be presenting 2 presentations about the findings of your understanding the data. It's really important. Then we will begin with the selecting model. And in the project report, you will see that there are the titles for specifically addressing this issue. So while you are building a machine learning solution, so let me say that while you are building your project, you should answer, or at least keep in mind what you need to answer, write, and present in the project. What questions your team is trying to answer? Do you think the data collected can answer that question? What is the best way to phrase my questions as a machine learning problem? Have I collected enough data to present the problem I want to solve? So these 5 questions, please note that at the 3rd week, the presentation, you have to be answering these, okay? So in these questions, okay, you have to address, let me show you. You see that here you have to introduce your project data set, present your project data set. Remember, introduce your project data set, present your project data set. So in these presentations, okay, you need to answer this kind of questions in the presentation and in the introduction. Okay, you need to, as a team, one of the team members should present in 5 or 10 minutes to these questions. How many features you have? What kind of features you have? What's your problem? Do you think that the number of samples are enough or not? So you need to work on these questions for the week 3 and 5 presentations. Am I clear?
Yes.
Okay, so that's the questions that I would like to see the answers from your project team for the selected data set. And it continues, of course, like that. Okay, what features of the data did I extract? And will these enable to write predictions? So you have a common sense that if with these features, can I do this or not? How I will measure the success in my applications? So the metrics I will cover later, but I will give you the very simple idea in an example in a moment. How will the machine learning solutions interact with other parts of my research or business product? So actually, my project. Okay. So I would like to see these questions answers in the third and fifth week presentation. And then you need to improve the answers throughout the project. Maybe sometimes you need to go back and create new features. I will explain these later, but you need to work on it. The question about understanding your data. Okay, in a larger context, the algorithms and methods in machine learning are only one part of the greater process. The big picture is that you collect data, you clean it up, you set up your features, reshape your features, organize your features, and relate with the problem, and then you are ready to apply some machine learning models on it. Okay, it does not mean that randomly select some model, apply it. Randomly select and apply it to the data set. It's not like that. It's not will be the in the projects. So in the projects, if you say that I select KNN, you need to justify why you select KNN. So to justify the selection of some machine learning model, you need to relate with the problem, the data set. Okay. So when going deep into the technical aspects of machine learning, we are gonna go. It is easy to lose sight of the ultimate goals. While we will not discuss the questions listed here in detail, so we need to keep in mind that what about the problem, what is the relationship with data set, and the result that we are seeking for. So we still encourage you to keep in mind that all the assumptions that you might be making explicitly or implicitly when you start building machine learning models. So you think you have some assumptions about the data set, saying that by using this data set, I can predict this target value, but it's an assumption. So you need to go over and understand and check, double check that if it is possible in common senses. Okay, don't forget, garbage in, garbage out. Any questions so far?
I have one, sir.
Yes, please.
For these data sets, are we going to trim out the parts that we will not use? Like, let's say the model of the car is not important for our study. Are we going to trim that out, or it will remain?
If you like, yes. If you like, yes. It is your project goal, so you need to state project goal specifically. If the project goal is like that, maybe you don't need this feature and the other feature, or in the target, maybe you only related for example, sedan or sports car. Then you say that I don't care about the manufacturer, but I need to only predict if it's a sedan or sports car. You understand? Then you can map from that car company, blah, 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 to the only the new target videos, sports, sedan, wagon, I don't know. Okay, it is about your project goal. It's up to you. But of course, in the presentation, you need to explain, and in the report, you need to explain.
Okay.
Is it clear?